William, hopefully your favorite videographer from Two Hats Publishing. I welcome you to another Two Hats special of community events. Let's look in and see what's really happening.
Now we revolution.
All right, I'm going to tell you why you guys are all still moving. Let's get out of, like, seriously, if you're in one of the back three rows, you are no longer having a chair in, like, 20 minutes. So get up from the chairs and come forward, because we need those chairs for something else. There's a bunch of kids coming to play musical chairs. We need them outside. We make kids that are homeless play outside, because that's what they're used to. Oh, my God, did she just make a homeless joke? She did. All right, thank you for moving forward. While you guys are moving forward, everyone has these really awesome folders, and I bet you noticed that there's no stickers or labels, and that's because we're inclusive. We invited every Bernie today. That's Dem Exit, Dem Enter, Independent, I don't know what politics is, every kind of Bernie, okay? They're all here. Yeah, give yourselves a round of applause. We're all here, every different kind of Bernie. And to that end, I wanted everyone to be able to label themselves. Not other people labeling you, but label yourself. So I made these fancy ass stickers. And I say they're fancy because you have to put them in like just the right way. And stickers. All right. So one is I'm a Dem Enter, Bern Green, Dem Exit, Independent. I stand with unions. Like all of us stand with unions. Bernocrat running for office, anyone? The Bernie in me recognizes the Bernie in you. That's a good one. Still Sanders, feel the burn. Those are good hashtags. You know how to get Lauren to a protest? It turns out I didn't want to protest at the DNC, but guess what I did? I protested. Guess why? Because someone said, hey, come on, we're going to protest. That's how you get me to go to a protest. So this one says, did someone say protest? Yes, so take your own sticker, pick your two, three, I don't care. There's not enough for everyone to be everything, but I'm sure that there's enough for everybody to be something. All right, now I'm going to introduce the session. Thank you for coming forward. Thank you for emptying the chairs in the back. That way we can secretly take them to the other place. Now, this is the Dem Enter. And we have shipped in some awesome people to talk to you. We got one all the way from Tennessee. She's known to the Bernie delegates as the girl getting the money. And that's Katie Tillman. Where's Katie? Come on up, Katie. Uh-oh, did we lose her? Come on down, you're the next contestant in Dem Enter. We also need Joshua, or Josh, from New Hampshire. Come on up. We need...
Who else?
Paul Heller, Michael Messer. Come on up to the stage. I think we have enough chairs for everyone. And if not, there's some empty ones in the back. We'll bring one up for you. All right, so this is going to be a panel discussion. Kristi, Lara is going to walk you through this. Basically, we invited you here today to make sure you understand all the parts of the revolution. We're not all going to head in the same direction as we leave here, because we all live in different places. And we all feel revolution in different ways, and we need to see that in each other, and we need to support each other. So I'm Dem Enter, but that doesn't mean I won't go to your DAPL protest. Okay, I'm Dem Enter, but that doesn't mean I can't show up to a green conference and talk about the climate change problem. Okay, so we can be all of the above, but focus on our own part of the revolution. So we're going to tell you what Dem Enter is, why it exists, what it means, and how to do it. And then we're going to talk about how you can support those that are doing it, because that's what's most important. Because in the progressive movement, as we found out, there's a lot of obstacles, and one is working together, even if we don't want to do what the other one is doing. So I'm Dem Enter, but I'm not saying you need to be Dem Enter. I'm saying you need to support me in my Dem Enter and tell me what you're doing, and I'll support you. And that's it. You're a Bernie, I'll support you. The end. And that's the same for Dem Enter. I don't care how you feel about the Democratic Party. I don't like the Democratic Party, but I'm going to change the Democratic Party. And that's why I'm Dem Enter. We can't change it from the outside, but we need a lot of pressure from the outside so that as we're inside pushing out, we are crushing them from both sides. Kristi, Lara, take it away. Oh, and one note about lunch. Everybody sit still after the event, and I will be after the demo intersection, and I will come and explain how lunch will work.
Hi, everyone. I hope everyone is having a fantastic time. We definitely wanted to make it about all of us, right? Not any one person. So I think we're accomplishing that. Dem Enter, how many people here know what Dem Enter is? A few people do. So Dem Enter was initially a response to Dem Exit. Does anybody here know what Dem Exit is? Woo, all right. So many of us at the DNC, I was a Bernie Sanders delegate, we had a lot of pressure on us to decide what we were going to do and how we were going to represent Bernie Sanders people at the DNC. And some people chose to Dem Exit, but many of us said, this is our party. We are the progressive party, and we have a different vision. And we listened to what, We listened to what Bernie told us, and what Bernie said is, we need to become the party of the working class. We need to begin speaking about the 99%, and we need to start speaking about income inequality and all of the things that bring us here today as Bernie Sanders supporters. So that's what Dem Enter means to me. Dem Enter could mean something totally different to someone else, but it is a way that I can facilitate what I consider to be Bernie Sanders' message of progressive politics within the Democratic Party. And what we say is bringing the progressive back into the Democrats, right? That's what we want to achieve. And there are several ways to achieve that. And these individuals up here represent how we would begin doing that. And I don't mean to put anybody on the spot, but Lawrence, if you want to join us, you're welcome to. I apologize, I know Lauren didn't call you up. but so everyone up here represents a different kind of Dem Enter strategy. And what that, Paul Heller does a lot of work for precinct chairs here in Dallas County, and he has a lot of information about how to become a precinct chair, how to work with a precinct chair, what that is, how to become elected as a precinct chair, and what exactly that entails. Michael Messer here has written a bill for 2017. It's an education bill, and I will let him talk more about that. Josh is visiting us, and he has some specific tactics that he's using in his state. He's running right now to become the chair of his party in that state, so he will give us that perspective. And Katie Tillman, who here knows Katie Tillman? All right! Katie Tillman ran a successful campaign to help fund the Bernie delegates to the DNC. She was a major component of the Fund Bernie Delegates team. That's how we met. That's how I met Katie, and she helped raise over $1 million to get Bernie delegates to the DNC. It was a huge team effort. We came together across the nation. We didn't know each other, but we worked day and night, not sleeping. And I'll tell you, Katie did not sleep for many months. And we're so thankful for all of her hard work. So she's here to talk about that work that she did. So we just want to go through. Michael will need to pass this out. This green sheet is Michael's draft of the legislation that he's presenting this session. So I want you guys to take a look at that. And before we begin, as we pass that out, I wanted to do a fun little exercise for you guys. So if everybody could stand up. And there was one of my favorite things when I was little, I used to always get in trouble when I went to church because I was a little fidgety and I liked to talk a lot. And so my favorite part of church was when we would turn to each other and we would say, "Peace be with you and also with you." And so coming here today, that's kind of the energy I feel about all of you. So if you could each turn to your right and shake the person's hand next to you and say, "Not me, us." Oh, that's right. And if you could turn to your left and look at the person to your left and shake their hand and say, "Not me, us."
Not me, us. I love you just the way you are.
Because one of the things I left with 2016 and why Bernie Sanders touched so many of our hearts is because he reminded all of us that it's going to take every single one of us, whether you're Dementor or Green Party or fighting for Native American rights and sovereignty or fighting for clean water or out here just trying to make the world a better place. It will take all of us to make that vision come true. And we're not gonna go away. We're fighters. We're gonna continue with the fight. And that's what we hope that you will do and help us as we work through Dementor. So I'm gonna have everyone come up and talk about what their specific goals are here in Dementor. And we'll take questions from you guys if you guys have questions from certain people, okay? Does that sound good? All right. You can sit down now. So, Paul Heller, how many people here are precinct chairs? Rock on! All right, give ourselves a hand of applause. How many people know what a precinct chair is? Awesome, rock on. Okay, so that's how we're going to change the party, right? What Bernie Sanders tells us is from the bottom up, right? So we're going to start at the bottom, and Paul Heller is a gentleman I met when I first moved to Dallas. He's an advocate for placing precinct chairs. He's done an amazing job advocating for those here in Dallas. And he's gonna tell us a little bit about what is going on in Dallas and how we can affect change in our communities, mirroring what happens here in this specific county. I know we're all from different parts of the state, but this is just a sample of what's going on across the state. Here's Paul. Thanks, Paul.
All right. Thank you. Hello. I got the little Dem Enter sticker, and I got involved in the party in 2000. You remember 2000? You remember who chose our president? That really pissed me off. So that's when I first got involved in the party. I went to a precinct convention. There were three people there, the current chair, myself, and one other. And I said, "Hi, I've not met you before. I'm Paul Heller. I live in the precinct." He said, "I'm John." I forgot his last name. And he said, "Wow, good to see you." I said, "I'm thinking of getting involved in the party." He said, "How would you like to be the chair?" He had been doing it for 10 or 12 years and said, "I'd be delighted to turn it over to you." So so that's how I became chair. One of the reasons I wanted to get involved in the party is I've always considered myself a liberal and politically liberal and active, but I never sort of saw the Democratic Party as all that liberal. So one of the reasons I got involved was to turn the party back to where I thought it should be, which is definitely liberal and progressive. And I noticed David Griggs is still here. He won't let the word out. I think he's a progressive too. And precinct chairs are very influential in the party. Let me tell you some of the mechanics. You have your paper out, ready to take notes. First thing is, what precinct are you in? Now, I'm talking mainly about Dallas County, but there's something similar in other counties. To find out what precinct you're in, go to dallascountyvotes.org. No punctuation except for the dot, dallascountyvotes.org. And if you look across the menu, There's a place where you can enter your name, your full name and birth date, and it will tell you, one, if you're registered, and what precinct you're in. That's a four-digit number. That's important because precinct chairs serve as the representative of their precinct. So you need to know what precinct you're in. How do you know who your current chair is or if it's vacant? Well, take that four-digit number, which is the precinct you live in, and go to DallasDemocrats.org. DallasDemocrats.org. And if you poke around, if you look at there's a precinct chair toolkit or something like that, go in there and you dig it deeply enough, you'll find a list of all the precinct chairs in Dallas County by precinct number. So go down to the precinct that you're in and see if there's a name next to it. It'll show a name and a phone number. That is your precinct chair if you have one. Get to know your precinct chair. If they're like-minded, support them. If you're not like-minded, plan to run against them at the next opportunity, which would be the next primary, which is in March of every even-numbered year. So that would be in 2018. The term of the precinct chair is 2 years. Let's say you look up your precinct and there's no name next to it. There's a name for that. What is it?
Vacant.
It's vacant. The procedure for filling a vacant precinct is quick and easy. I understand we're going to print out some of the applications. If your precinct has no current chair, what you need to do is fill out the form for a precinct chair vacancy application. And I think we're going to have some of those forms later in the day. They're also on the Dallas County or Dallas Democrats website. You fill that out, name, precinct, address, and so forth. The next opportunity, when the precinct is vacant midterm, which is what we are now, the way they're selected and approved is by the sitting precinct chairs. Every quarter they have a meeting, and those who have applied for the vacant chairs are presented to the existing precinct chairs for approval. In almost every case, how many people do you think run for each precinct that's vacant? One. So the chances that you're going to get elected if you're unopposed are very good, even if you don't show up. But we would like for you to show up. The next quarterly meeting is January 30th, and it's in this room. You need to have that application in and completed by noon of the preceding business day, which would be about January, Friday the 27th, is it? Look at a calendar, that's how you figure that out. But by noon Friday, have that application in to the party office, and you would then be presented for approval on Monday the 30th. And I hope you would come, even if you're not applying to be precinct chair. It's an open meeting for Democrats. You'll find out what precinct chairs do and what the party does. There are 797 precincts in Dallas County. That's a lot of precincts. About maybe 50 of them have no voters. They might be a lake, for example, or a median. The precincts have anywhere from no voters up to about maybe 5,000 registered voters. So the size of your precinct in terms of number of voters varies dramatically. We have there's a precinct that covers Love Field per se. It has 15 voters. We have a chair whose address is one of the hangars at Love Field. But he's the voting precinct chair, has the same vote. It's kind of like the Electoral College, you know, where every state, I'm sorry. Every precinct chair has the same vote in the party. So we have 797, about 50 of them are have no voters. Probably another 100 or so have less than 100 voters, so they're quite small. The rest vary from 100 to 4,000. The typical precinct has about 2,500 voters. Of those, say 700 chairs that have people, about half of them are filled, so 350 of the precincts in Dallas County are vacant. So They're not randomly distributed, but it's about a 50-50 chance that if you're randomly distributed in the county, you'll find that your precinct is vacant. So I expect you to apply if you have any questions. The people who are current chairs or past precinct chairs, raise your hands again, hold them up, look around and find someone who has their hand up. They will tell you what it's like, either as a current chair or previous chair, and can help you make it through the procedures, which are pretty simple. I'll be around. You can ask me. Did I miss anything about being a precinct chair? What did they do? They are an official of the party. Ordinarily, they're elected in the primary, just like other candidates. So what we were talking about was midterm vacancies. All the precincts are open, just like all the House seats in Congress and all the state representatives. All those seats are open every 2 years. So if you're in a precinct that has an incumbent, if they're great, work with them or challenge them. If they're not so great, definitely challenge them. You do that by just the same way you would run for the state house. You fill out a different form. You file for office. Those forms are on the Secretary of State's website as well as DallasDemocrats.org. It's a little more complicated. It has to be notarized. The election is the primary in March of 2018. That's our next primary. The deadline for filing is typically somewhere in December or so. So if your chair is occupied, that's your next opportunity to be a chair. If it happens to be occupied now, talk to the current chair. It might be someone like my previous chair who said, "You're willing to do this? Fine." Have them resign in writing, and then you're open to fill that vacancy. What does the precinct chair do? The one sort of official task of the precinct chair is to get the people in their precinct out to vote Democratic in every partisan election. There are a variety of other things you can do. You have some tools that allow you to do that. One is a database of all the voters in your precinct, whether they're Republican or Democrat or non-voters. So you have information like name, address, voting history, telephone number, maybe email. So you have some information about how to contact them, places to put information that you get about them. If they've answered previous survey questions, that information is also there. So a precinct chair has access to that database, and you can get training on how to use it. It's called VAN. The chairs who are active can tell you a little about VAN. In this past year, we did pick an interim chair, the precinct chairs, picked an interim county chair, who is the current chair, Carol Donovan. She ran in 2016 and was reelected. We also picked two of the nominees for judge positions. Dallas County is a Democratic county, so almost, except for the DA appointed by the governor, all of the other countywide positions are Democratic. So the precinct chairs picked two of the judge nominees to be on the Democratic ballot in November, who then became judges. So that's a case, either through resignation or death, at the right time, it's sent up to the precinct chairs to pick those nominees.
And there's another major function. They are members of the executive committee of the Democratic Party in that county. And they have meetings with all other precinct chairs on a monthly basis. And they make all the decisions, vote on the decisions that are being made by the county chair as to whether they're approved or not. So they have an executive function to help run the party and their parents. Very important.
Yeah. Also, a lot of the chairs are judges during the election.
Right.
That's very important that to have people that we want in those places when the election comes around.
The election judges, on election day, a person in the precinct or a nearby precinct is the election judge, and a person in the alternate of the other party is an alternate judge. If you're precinct chair, it doesn't mean you have to be the judge, and vice versa. They're disconnected, but many of the precinct chairs are judges or alternates, depending on the flavor of their precinct. It's critical if you want to have legal elections and have qualified voters able to vote. I think Mickey is telling me something. That's many. Ooh. One more question, and then I'll be around all day, and you can ask me later, or others.
I don't know how they do it in Dallas County, but in Tarrant County, if there is no opposition to the incumbent precinct chair, they don't even put that precinct chair's name on the ballot. So if you're going down the ballot marking names, you're not going to ever see your precinct chair's name on your ballot. I don't know if they do that.
Same in Dallas.
Yeah, yeah. But to me, that's detrimental to getting activism in
How many don't live in Dallas County? Holy moly. Well, I'm glad you're here. It's a blue county. What I said about Dallas County, there are analogous tools and capabilities in other counties. Go to this, if you want to find out what precinct you're in, go to the Secretary of State's website. You've got to enter a little more information, but there you will find out what precinct you're in, and then you can follow the same process to see if it's vacant and so forth. That's all the time I have.
President Truman left the White House. He wanted to go back to Independence, Missouri to be a precinct chair.
Holy moly.
The most important job.
There it is.
All right, so come drink the Kool-Aid.
Okay, and next we're going to have Lawrence, and he's just going to give you a few moments of what he's experienced here running for office.
Hi, I'm Lawrence Prager. I'm a lifelong Democrat, and I've had the opportunity and the pleasure to have run for two different offices. I'm a practicing attorney, lifelong Democrat. I ran for the 5th District Court of Appeals. And I know when you, one of the things I learned in politics is when you get up before a group and you talk about the Court of Appeals, everyone sort of glazes over. But let me tell you how important, I want to tell you two things, how important these appellate court races are, particularly in a community or in a state where we have a paralyzed legislature. If it weren't for an appellate court justice's decision, we would not have marriage equality, and we wouldn't have the Affordable Care Act. And you've heard very much that Dallas is a blue county. Well, that's true. But there are 13 members of the Courts of Appeal. Every single member of the Court of Appeal in Dallas County is a Republican. So what's interesting, the Courts of Appeal, those races are very important. The reason why they're Republican and not Democratic is that the Court of Appeals race is a 6-county district. They're not considered statewide, and they're not considered local. But when you remember, when you go down the ballot and you're looking at the Court of Appeals, you think if any of the judges' decisions gets overturned, it goes to a all-Republican and, frankly, right-wing Court of Appeals. And that's just not my opinion. The University of Houston did a study of the appellate decisions over the last 20 years, and what they said was that if you want a court that favors business interests and employers over employees, you go to the Courts of Appeals in Texas. So I'm here today to get everyone, if anyone's interested in running for judge, I know a lot of the, I can give you help on dealing with the Democratic clubs and give you my personal experience in dealing with the local parties in 6 counties and dealing with the paid consultants. And what I like to talk about, or one last thing, and my name's Lawrence Prager. You can call me at my law office. It's very important that you pay particular close attention to judicial races, because for the fact of the matter is most of them are funded by lawyers who have an interest in the outcome of those races. So it looks like most of you are not asleep yet. The most important race are your appellate court decisions, particularly in a deadlocked legislature. Thank you very much.
And next, we will have Michael Messer talk about his legislative. That's this green paper that we passed out here.
All right. Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
My name is Michael Messer. I am the founding president of Collin County Young Democrats. I am the founder of the Friendly Neighborhood Democrats. I am the DFW organizer for Save Texas Schools, and I ran for Justice of the Peace in the last election.
Woo!
Thank you.
And he's a Bernie.
Yes, absolutely. Today I'm here to get you interested in something that is absolutely not sexy, the law. This right here is a bill that I crafted in the last couple weeks to modify the existing education code here in Texas. Now, a lot of you are fairly well versed in activist interests. Who here hates the school to prison pipeline? All right. Who here hates standardized testing? All right. So this bill essentially takes what we know of the standardized test and throws it out. What we're told right now by the Texas state legislature is that the standardized test costs a total of $90 million a year. $90 million. Now, the contract itself is $90 million. The consultants are part of that $90 million. But what's not included in that $90 million is the salaries of the teachers that have to proctor the test, the salary of the teachers that are doing the test prep and the retesting. It doesn't include the maintenance and operations. It doesn't include keeping the lights on, keeping the heat on. It doesn't include the security that is in place for when these tests show up to the schools. It includes none of that. Now, according to a lot of articles and a lot of my friends who are school admins and teachers throughout the state, on average, they spend about 45 days a year in test prep and testing. That's about a quarter of their year that they spend in that alone. So instead of $90 million, if you look at the TEA reports, all the required financial reports that the school districts are to send in every year, and you use the 45-day figure there, it's much closer to $13 billion that we spend per year on the test. That is one-fifth of our entire public education budget. But we don't know that because it's not on the report. It's not required on the report. As it stands right now, education code requires that the TEA commissioner dictate what is to be specified on that report. And in the history of the TEA commissioner dictating that report, they've never required this. This specific bill modifies existing education code to require the districts to include a specific column on that report that states how much they spend per year in total on the test prep, and the retesting. Very simple, couple of lines that I add to the code, that's it. Now, what does this mean in the long run? It means that the public has access to that information. It means that you and I can go out into the public, and when we tell them something like it's $13 billion a year, and they say, where are you getting that number? We don't have to sit there and take all the TEA reports and do what I did, which, I mean, I'm an accountant by trade, so for me, this is fun. I took all the numbers and put them together, and I actually had a professor of education verify all the numbers and the assumptions to make sure I wasn't that far off base when I started spouting about this. But it gives the public that information. And when the public finds out that we're spending a fifth of our education budget on testing instead of educating their kids, It's going to change. And that's what we're here for, right? We want, as people who are progressive, as people who believe that the government is here as an extension of us, as we fund the government so that we can benefit from these programs that exist. We have an opportunity right here to make things for our children better for the future. Now, as of right now, I've had this bill in front of several education experts, school board members, teachers, administrators, superintendents, everybody, and they love it. You know, they had a couple of suggestions. One that I need to change on here, including but not limited to. That's a good one. That's definitely one that needs to be added. But they're all on board. I'm getting this into the hands of legislators right now, so what can you do for me? I need all of you, especially those who are really interested, to get this in the hands of your legislators. I need you to lobby for me. I need you to get this to them and say, look, this matters to my kids. This matters to all the kids in Texas. And I want you to pass it. And if you're interested in helping out, please send me an email. You can write this down. I didn't put it on the handout. It's Michael Messer, M-I-C-H-A-E-L, M-E-S-S-E-R, at live, that's L-I-V-E, .com. And like I said, I've been doing this for a couple of days. Already Donna Howard has expressed interest. We have a couple of different legislators that are hopefully going to be on board soon. And we'll get a sponsor as quick as possible. The earlier this legislation gets on the docket, the more likely it is that it's going to pass through committee, that it's going to get in front of the entire legislature, and that it'll get on Greg Abbott's desk, and we can force him to sign it. So please, if you have any questions.
The great thing about that is you can frame that as hold our schools accountable. The Republicans love accountability.
Yes.
And the
reason why I'm a progressive and an accountant is because I believe that if you look at the numbers and you actually analyze them, it's far more beneficial to all of us when we share. You know, it's the truth about democratic socialism is that in a lot of these markets that are inelastic in nature, if we privatize those markets, if we charterize those markets, if we deregulate those markets, it costs us all a lot more in the long run. This gives us a huge data point to show and say, as progressives, here's our facts. Here's something that we know is true that we can point out. It's not just our feelings. We care about these kids, of course. We care about the future, of course. But we also care about our pocketbooks. We care about how this money is spent. And we want it to be spent right. We want it to be spent to make sure these kids, all kids in Texas, have a high quality education. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Right now, I just sent it off to Donna Howard. She asked for it yesterday. And Jeff Leach, who is a Republican, that is my representative, I'm sending it to him today. He asked me to go ahead and send it to him. So I'm trying to get bipartisan support. Of course, here in Texas, if we don't get the Republicans on board, it's not going anywhere. So please, whether you like your representative or not, please, please, please send them this bill. I really need your help. Not at the moment. It's just on my Facebook page, but I can send you a PDF. If you want to send me an email, I'll send you a PDF right back to you. Kristi just offered to email it to everybody. It's on the events page. I love y'all. Y'all are awesome. Okay, we have one more question. Zach? Definitely. The state senators and the representatives, we need to have everybody on board. And then, of course, we need Greg Abbott to sign. Right now it's called, it doesn't have a specific title. I just called it an assessment expense reporting, which is very legalese. It's not, I don't really have a sexy name for it yet. But
a legislator would probably assign it a title once it's introduced to the body.
In front of that, it's
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yes. Send it now. Yeah, well, we can come up with a name afterwards. We need it in the legislature as soon as possible. The way that the bills in the legislature work is the earlier a bill gets into the earlier a bill is sponsored and put forth by the legislature, the likelier it is to actually pass through the committees and be voted on the floor. So that takes a little bit of time. Oh, the 20% of the budget that we're spending on testing right now.
What do we get in return for that?
Well, okay. So the reality of the standardized test is that over the years, all it's really ever proven, and this is study after study after study, all it's ever proven is that poverty sucks. You know, if you live in an impoverished neighborhood, if your parents are both working, let's say 3 to 4 jobs trying to make ends meet, they're not going to have time to spend with you to read every single night as much as your affluent peers. When they get to kindergarten, they are so far ahead that, you know, what do? And we don't have, thanks to the legislature, we've had budget cut after cut after cut after cut, and the class sizes have skyrocketed because we've lost teachers. Back in 2011, we lost 10,000 teachers after the cuts. And that's huge, but that was $5.4 billion in cuts over 2 years. Think about what if we freed up $13 billion.
Two more questions, Gary, and there was one other person, and then we have to...
Where did you say we can see the budget number that you
referenced? The TEA website. It's PIMS Financial Data.
PIM is Mary?
Yes, PIMS Financial Reports. And you do the statewide financial reports, and it gives you all income, all revenues and expenses by district statewide. So you can actually crunch all those numbers together. You can find out how much the state gives each district, how much you get from property taxes, how much you get from federal taxes, all that. Super sexy stuff, y'all. I'm telling you, I get high on this. It's awesome. Yes. There are a couple of bills being batted around. Usually whenever they talk about universal pre-K, it comes with a lot of stipulations. One of Greg Abbott's big ones is to put standardized testing in kindergarten. So, you know, let's not increase the amount of standardized testing. We want these kids to have an education before kindergarten, because there's a lot of them. And my wife was a public school teacher for well over 5-6 years in Garland ISD, which is an impoverished district. There were kids that were showing up that they were terrified of pens and pencils. They had never held one before. I mean, the disparity in starting points for these kids is so far behind. And the only thing that has ever been proven to in any way, shape, or form mitigate the effects of poverty on educational attainment is small class sizes. The only thing that has ever been proven to do it. And because of the cuts, and because of a couple of ALEC-related bills, you know, the class size requirements that we had for a couple of decades are gone. I gotta go, y'all. I'm getting kicked off. Thank y'all so much.
What's going on, you guys? My name is Joshua Adjutant, and in this last election cycle, I was running for state representative up in New Hampshire. And right now I'm running for the chairmanship of the Democratic Party up in New Hampshire. Yeah. One thing I can say specifically about Dem Enter is you don't have to like it. Just like when you were a kid and your parents told you to eat your broccoli, it's good for you, but you don't have to like it and you don't have to have fun. There were numerous instances while running as a Democrat, that I could have thrown my hands up in the air and said, they're making this way too complicated. They're making it so I can't say what I want to say. And I just need to, you know, drop out, quit. But the corruptible are always willing to take that seat. There is usually only a few seats of power. And those that would misuse that office are more than happy to take it away from the good-willed. If we do not beat the establishment at their own game, then we will consistently fall victim to the corruptible. I was a history major in school, so some of you might know the story of Colonel Stauffenberg. During the Second World War, the military intelligence office in Germany launched a plot to use the rules of the Nazi government against itself. There was some arbitrary law that Hitler had signed called Operation Valkyrie, where if he was assassinated, the German reserve army would have taken over. And Stauffenberg knew this. He didn't like being a Nazi anymore. He didn't like what he saw fighting in Africa, so he decided to use the rules of the organization against itself. And that's exactly what I think we can do. Every person that operates now within the establishment of the Democratic Party was at one point a county delegate, and was at one point a state delegate, and as it was at one point a volunteer. We do not need millions and millions of people to make this work. Realistically, we probably only need 500,000. By taking over local chairs, and by taking over local districts, and by taking over county districts, we can eventually starve state committees and do the real things that we want to do. Yeah. Debbie Wasserman Schultz did not have as much power. She did not have as much power as people thought she did. In fact, if any of you know anything about the Hillary Victory Fund, which was the plan that the committee used to siphon money up to Hillary Clinton's campaign, that was approved by state committees. People that, if you operate within the Democratic complex, you probably know personally. I think this is the best way for us to proceed. You don't have to like it, but we have to do it. It's all set. Thank you.
And last but not least, Katie Tillman.
Hey everybody, I'm Katie Tillman. I am from Halletown, Tennessee, which is a teeny little dot west of Chattanooga. I want to talk about fundraising for a little bit and how you can get involved, what we've done, and how we're using it going forward. I had a friend in my county that became a Bernie delegate, and we were sitting on my porch after the district convention, super excited, and she was like, okay, now I got to come up with $3,000 or $4,000 and figure out how I'm going to get there. And she said she'd heard people use GoFundMe accounts to start trying to raise money. So I was like, well, I bet delegates everywhere are doing that. So I decided, of course, nowadays what we do is Facebook, social media. So I made a group called Delegates and Friends for Bernie Sanders 2016. And it was specifically to invite all the delegates and supporters in for delegates. It's open, public, but it's only allowed posting for funding. And then we created share teams where we had volunteers. We organized all of the lists, and then we had shares going into the largest Bernie groups all over Facebook. We also used Twitter, so that those links were going out every day, all day long, in the groups, commenting them, bumping up to the top of the feed. If you saw delegates and friends funding posts, make a comment, say something, so it goes right back up the feed in the Bernie groups. And this went on for months. And then it turned into a website. Michael Doyle created FundBernieDelegates.com through our lists and organizations. And FundBernieDelegates.com then got us organized further to, oh, just go here, it's easier. And then we started sharing the website out. So you could go to your state, you could go to delegates per your state. So now we're going to take that concept and move it forward to candidates. So our newest group that was just created is Delegates and Friends, because we have to keep our name. We love that. That's how we all got together and connected. Delegates and Friends Revolution Funding is what it's called. So you can go on Facebook, join that group. And it's not, the money doesn't come to us. The money goes straight to the candidates. So if you're interested in fundraising, join the group, shoot me a message. You can email me at ktillman, T-I-L-L-M-A-N, at democraticpulse.com. And you, as far as being on share teams, you can work for a month, you know, a few hours a week, or you can work for the next 2 years and do it for an hour a week or an hour a month. It doesn't matter. Whatever works on your schedule and what you can do. We can also customize our process if you just want to work for Texas and blast out on social media all of your Texas candidates. We can organize our process to work just for your state. And I think that's it. Yeah. Does anybody have any questions? Has anybody done fundraising on a social media spectrum before? Awesome. Well, some of them were like in through the group. All right. Oh.
When there are reporting requirements that you have to get details about contributions, how do you deal with that?
We don't have to do any FEC filing because we don't take any money. What we do is connect and share the link of that candidate. So if you were running for a position, whether it's mayor, city council, Congress, whatever position, we share your link and we put a write-up at the top of it about you as a candidate, and then we blast it around. So we're not taking in money. You're getting the money directly as a candidate, and we're doing the grassroots work to share it out and get it seen everywhere, all the time, over and over. Thank you. All right. Thanks, y'all. Oh, Delegates and Friends Revolution Funding.
The name of the Facebook group is Delegates and Funds of Delegates and Friends of Revolution Funding. Facebook it. I also want to say that Bernie Sanders showed us, right? He showed us how to do it. We all believed we could do it, but now we saw us in action this year. And us is pretty awesome, y'all. And so what I want to say is never before have millions of Americans gave their $27 to self-fund a national campaign for the presidency of the United States. We did that, and you guys need to take a hand. People like Katie, those of us that stood up and demanded that our voices be heard. And I want you to leave today knowing that your voice is so important within the Democratic Party. Your voice is so important in the work that we do moving forward, whether you're a precinct chair or a block captain, or you're writing legislation, or you run for a county seat, or you help do fundraising, or you run or help a judge run. Whatever your role is, you are putting our progressive voice into our communities. So I invite you to join us, and I invite you to be not me, but us. Right. Blessings, 2017. Are there any other questions before we leave? Is everybody good?
We have a question.
I guess this is just for the whole panel, like on kind of more like a philosophical question for Dem Exit, but I mean Dem Exit, sorry. how do y'all plan on making sure that while like we can use the Democratic Party to get our agenda across, that we don't become reliant on them? Because a lot of, you know, progressive organizations, New York, for example, the Working Families Party, they wound up endorsing Andrew Cuomo, who just recently vetoed a bill to raise funding for working families. So how do we make it so that like we have some teeth in that regard?
Thank you for your question. I wasn't on the panel, but I'm about to answer this question. Don't put me near a mic, people. And you need to stall. The sandwiches aren't here yet, so. You know, that's an awesome question because it's the same question I've had. Like, how do you dem enter when once you get in there, you know what it is all about? It's already been. We've seen it happen. I told you already, I'm not millennial. I've voted a few times. And then every time they turn around and do the same thing that I thought they weren't going to do. And it's not fair. And so instead of just being around like going to boo-hoos, you know, oh, it's just not fair. What we're going to do is we're only going to support people that are only willing to take our little money. That's what we're going to do. We're only going to support Bernie-crats. And people that don't like the word Bernie-crats, but actually will still only take the little money, that's what we're gonna do. And it's the only way it's gonna happen. We're gonna topple the oligarchy, people. Yeah. I'm a very positive thinker. I mean, I know it's gonna take 150 years, so everybody have some kids and let them have some kids. And we have a question, guys. Oh, an answer. Oh, that's right.
Texas, you need to follow up on that. You need to show up there at your office, and you need to get Bible bill passed. You need to find out what other things are.
He thinks he's going to be done with the light on now.
Next week, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So we need to find out what bills are coming up, and what, you know, are they affect old people? Do they affect, you know, schools, whatever they affect, and whatever your issues are, you need to show up and go down to Austin if you can, or at least, you know, call them, email them, and be a pain, okay? That's how democracy works.
So just to...
Voting is one part of it, but...
Just in case you didn't hear Bob, Bob is an advocate, not just for our communities, not just for the Democrats, but for Texas Alliance for Retired Americans. Let's give them a hand. Amazing advocacy in Dallas. But what he was saying, in case you couldn't hear him, was that we need to become the change we hope to see in the world. And one of the ways that we can do that is to go to the legislature and start to lobby for the issues that are important, the issues that we are passionate about. You know, in April, we know that CWA takes buses down to Austin to try to fight for state wages and rights for union workers. We know that Planned Parenthood goes down there to fight for women's rights. We know the Women's Rights March is coming up later on in January, right? We're gonna support that. And so many of these dates are already filled out on the calendar, and the ACLU is a great resource for us to find out when those lobby days are. And I know I am transportation challenged, so if someone has a bus going down to Austin from Dallas, I am more likely to take it. But I would encourage you also, I've on several occasions taken Megabus or carpooled with my friends, especially, you know, those of us that were at the Wendy Davis filibuster, we all carpooled there, you know, constantly to advocate on behalf of women's rights here in Texas. And so those issues, although it is hard work and it's long work, it's important work, right? So we encourage each of you to get involved with legislative duties and actions and sign up for those lobby days.
Do you mind if I hop in on this question?
Yes, go ahead.
I think ultimately the best way to combat that kind of taking advantage is a dual approach of shame and replacement. So we all saw what happened last week with the Office of Congressional Ethics and how the plan to gut that was very quickly reversed due to a massive outcry of what are you doing? Why is this the first thing? Why is this a thing? So specifically in New Hampshire, we had a piece of legislation that came up, and it was the epitome of easy political bills. The bill would have made it illegal for a lobbyist to testify on the floor of the State House before a citizen could. So they would ask, you know, have all citizens, you know, testified. Okay, now we can do registered lobbyists now that we've given everybody a chance to speak. Should have been a very easy bill. Would have been a wonderful opportunity for our Democratic caucus to point fingers at the Republicans for the next 2 years and say, thank you for not voting for that. You just gave us a plus up. Half the Democratic caucus voted against it. It was what I would describe as a political softball sitting on a tee. Was a very easy piece of legislation that we should have gotten through. Unfortunately, it died after it got out of committee. So our response to that was public shaming and targeted public shaming. I promise you, your congressman does not read your Facebook comments. But calling your congressman, making public visuals, and trying to get that information out on a broader spectrum, and then replacement. You know, there, once that vote happened, I started looking at those Democratic districts and picking out more progressive Democrats that I knew would have voted for that, and were slating them to run in 2018. So if shaming doesn't work, then replacement has to.
As a final comment, I think your question is the most, one of the most important, what you can do on a local level. My political experience, to make a long story short, you're not going to win every battle. And it's kind of like being a lawyer. I remember I lost a trial one time, and the client was sitting next to me, and he said, well, at least the process was fair. So on a local level, when you talk about selecting candidates and supporting issues, what you should do, and I think what the difference between the Bernies and the establishment is, ask yourself, who's selecting these candidates? When you see Democratic cards that say some PAC, who's behind the PAC? Who's providing the money? Is the process of raising people up to run for office, is it fair? Did we all have equal input? And it's not very interesting, but the integrity of the process, you can live in a party that doesn't agree with you all the time, if the processes within the party are open, fair, we know where the money comes from, we know when all the meetings are happening, and we know who the hierarchy is. And I think the saddest thing about this cycle is that what happened on the national level, I think Debbie Wasserman Schultz and one of my former heroes, Donna Brazile, alienated a whole generation of young people who supported Bernie. And I don't want to see that happen. It's starting to happen a little bit at the state convention, and I think that's why we're all here. So the integrity of the process is important.
Yes.
Come up. Come on. You're the next contestant on Dementor.
Door number 1, 2, or 3.
Okay. There we go.
If Paul can make it, you can make it.
I'm the same age as Bernie, so I have an excuse. Anyway, this was in the 80s. Jim Wright had resigned from Congress. It was an open election. So there was a field of candidates. Being an open election, anybody could run. You had Democrats, you had Republicans. Pete Guerin was elected. He's what we call a blue dog Democrat. And the issue at the time that I was involved with that got me started in all of this was Central America. We had an interreligious task force group. Where's Lon Burnham? There you are, Lon. Okay. Lon Burnham, Pat Bonner from California. I consider my two mentors that got me involved in all of this. So, Lon, thank you. Anyway, we bird dogged Pete Guerin at his town halls where he was getting to know his constituency. And we always brought up the issue of Central America. What was the United States doing, et cetera, et cetera. And so he was getting constant critical commentary from the audience. We were doing it not just to approach him, but to educate the people who were there to hear him. It was like not until the third town hall that this guy finally figured out that he needed to have a plant in the audience to immediately stand up and say something really wonderful about him. We had an endorsing meeting of the local Hispanic Democratic group, and I rose before that small group, and I suggested that because of a couple of reasons, that we not endorse Pete Guerin. Well, you're not a Democratic group, and you just plain come out and not endorse somebody without some feedback on it. And so he was not notified that the group had agreed that they were not going to endorse him for the reasons that I stated. And so he was pretty pissed about it. And he, being a Blue Dog Democrat, also had the problem, from my point of view, is that every time there was an important vote that the Republicans were supporting, he was one of the few Democrats who voted along with the Republicans. I wrote a letter to the editor. Never underestimate the power of a letter to the editor. And I made that argument about why is he running as a Democrat when he's voting with the Republicans so often against our interests. And I begged for a real Democrat to run for office so I could use all of my political skills to help them. I got phone calls as a result of that letter to the editor from other Democrats who felt the same way. Shortly thereafter, they reported in the newspaper that he hadn't raised much money for his upcoming election, not much at all, and shortly thereafter, he made it known he was not running for re-election. What he basically did was he softened up that Democratic seat of Jim Wright for a Republican, Kay Granger, because she had run as a mayor, which is a nonpartisan seat, and a lot of Democrats in Tarrant County had voted for her. So they felt comfortable voting for her again, running as a Republican. Okay? So now we have Kay Granger, who's been in that office for years and years. But the fact that I said those things, he was not endorsed, pissed off, letter to the editor, didn't run. Of course, I don't take credit for the fact that he didn't run again. You know, he ended up in Bush's administration. So that tells you. But it's called bird dogging, being consistent. One of the issues we talked about, be consistent with your Democrats. If it's something the Republicans do that you don't like and a Democrat does it, be consistent. If you protest the Republican, you better get out and protest the Democrat. That's it.
All right. Kristi, Lara has one quick thing to do. You don't want to do it.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you for the question.
Yes.
Zachary?
Zachary.
I would just like to say, I don't think
he's going to say it.
There are a lot of divisions between Clinton and Sanders supporters, but I think it's important that the candidates that we choose on the issues. A lot of Clinton supporters, I've noticed, agree more with Sanders than Clinton. So I think it's important that we don't have that test of whether they were a Clinton supporter or a Sanders supporter. Yes. I've seen people say on Facebook these very nasty things about Sanders and then just turn around and say, oh, I love single payer. So it's important that we really focus on the issues and not become hyper-partisan.
Thank you, Zachary. Zachary was in Philly with us, and he had a really strong voice for us. Thank you for saying that, Zachary. I totally agree about Dem Enter and the vetting, and we have another question. Yes.
It's not a question, but it's a statement. Unbeknown to you all, the state Democratic chairman, Gilberto Hinojosa, is a closet Bernie supporter.
I felt I liked that guy.
I felt that.
I like
so,
that.
Look, the sandwiches are here. So, we want to thank you guys for being so amazing. What we also want to say to all of you is that just hearing everyone speak and seeing, I literally feel like I can see your voice. And what I want us to do just real quick to bring our energy up right before we eat is I want those of you in this room who have been fighting for progressive issues for more than 50 years to please stand up. Stand up. Let's give a round of hands. Woo! These are our fighters, our warriors. That's right. If you please stay standing, stay standing. I know I'm asking a lot. If you've been fighting for progressive issues for more than 40 years, please stand up. All right, there we go. Stay standing, stay standing. If you've been fighting for progressive issues for more than 30 years, please stand up. If you have been fighting for progressive issues for more than 20 years, please stand up. If you have been fighting for progressive issues for more than 10 years, please stand up. If you have been fighting for progressive issues for more than 5 years, please stand up.
That is a lot of people.
If you have been fighting for progressive issues since 2015, when Bernie Sanders first announced his candidacy, please stand up!
Thank you, Bernie. Thank you, Bernie.
If today is your first day to begin your fight in the revolution, please stand up! All of you remember, it's not me, it's us. Now go get your sandwiches and revolution!
Not yet, not yet. No sandwiches.
I'm sorry. We have a very small venue and a very large amount of people. We have a large amount of food, so no one's going hungry. We're going to do a little game, and it's called the Random Age Game. And we're going to start with the random age of 32 to 37. Please leave the room. And you will be directed to have lunch. And if all is right in the world, there's people out there ready to describe how to get your lunch. There's a hot food choice and a cold food choice, and everyone gets chips and fruit and vegetables. Good luck. Oh, there's sodas in the coolers. You can bring your food back in here. There's room in the kitchen now. We cleaned it up. Caterers are done. So if you're between 32 and 37, get in line. Now, if you're over,
75.
There you go. If you're over 75, please go have lunch. And Tarek, nice to see you. We block walked together at the gay club. That was us. Woohoo!
Hey, Rick, move.
started this and doesn't know where it goes.
I don't care.
Okay.
All right, next. Huh? Update on parking issues. So far, so good. Yeah, so far, so good. Some guy came out of a building and told us we were okay. And other than that, I think we've checked. And we'll check again in the afternoon for latecomers to make sure they're not in the wrong places. But we're good. Okay, if you are starving, get in line. There you go. I knew these girls would get out. These are Christian sisters, guys. Her parents don't feed them. They don't get fed. I don't know why. Christian's always hungry at my house. I don't understand. Feed your children, people. No, I'm kidding. They're all grown. They can get their own food. All right, if you are under 22, you better go get some food because you're hungry. If you are still sitting, be patient. Count to like 150. And then go get in line. But I am seeing the line start, and you're just going to be standing there, and I'm going to go make sure it's going all right because I'm a control freak. Welcome to lunch. It's a half an hour, and then it's the keynote speaker, Jim Hightower. Get ready, people. It's time to revolution.
This is William, hopefully your favorite videographer from 2X Publishing. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you like it, please leave comments below or like, follow, or subscribe to us and get notices of all our videos. We love it, even when you call.